In this video, I am going to talk about microservices interview questions. These interview questions are mostly conceptual based and related to practical use case of the project. So let's start. First question. Can we use embedded server in production for microservice? For creation of microservice in Java, Spring Boot is preferred, and Spring Boot has Tomcat as default embedded server. To answer this perfectly, you need to understand how the deployment things work before the coming of microservice architecture. Before the coming of microservice architecture, we usually have Tomcat as a standalone server, and we deploy the applications as var file or yar file to the Tomcat deployment folder. In production, instead of Tomcat, you may have Glassfish, you may have some other servers also. So for the production, we can say yes, we can use embedded server. The answer seems pretty simple, right? But when you say yes, the second question will be coming like, what would be the impact on the production load? So that's why I requested that you know how things work in the production before coming of the microservices architecture for your project. Then only you would be able to give the answer to the next question. So moving to next question. Will embedded server able to manage production load? To answer this, we can say yes, embedded server is able to manage production load. Now the point is, if you do not want to use the default embedded server, that is Tomcat, then Spring Boot also provides you Undertow, Jetty and Netty. So you can use them instead of Tomcat. Even in production, there is not going to be a single instance of your application. You should have at least 3 instances of the service running behind load balancers. So minimum 3 instances is a preferred way to manage the load depending upon the requirement use case. Moving to next question. Have you heard of strangulation pattern for microservices? If you have worked in a project where the migration of monolithic to microservices is going on, more or less the architecture is migrated with the help of strangulation pattern. So other way, the question would be like, which pattern of microservice you have used if you're migrating from monolithic to microservice? So strangulation pattern is used when you are migrating from a monolithic architecture to microservice. Now, the migration itself is not a easy process. If you have a big monolithic architecture which is a very tightly coupled with each other, it is a very hard to migrate your application. Also, you have to think of migration of your schema, tables and consequently database. So strangulation pattern says that if you have a big monolithic architecture, try to find out a point which could be an independent, and you can use this point as a trial version to test whether the separation of the logic is going good or not. So let's say out of this a big monolithic architecture, if we are able to find a small part of this architecture which could be separated then we can go with the strangulation pattern. So after this, what you would have, you have cut down a part from the architecture and it could be treated as an independent part. Now if the request comes, you would have a router, so you can push the request to this big monolithic application, and when the request comes for this part, so there is two way. Either you can directly route from router to this application, or you can go from router to this application and then from this application. And if the test is successful, you can independently call this application. So using this way, the big monolithic architecture would be divided into small parts, and each part will be separated from this big monolithic application gradually, and then a whole independent microservice architecture would come into existence. Moving to next question. How would you decompose business into microservice? Now, this question tests your whole knowledge of microservice. Generally, this question is asked when you have a tech lead experience or a manager or architect level of experience. But again, if you try to understand the business, how it impacts the business, how it will impact your architecture design, it would be useful to you. So for decomposition of a particular business into microservice, we usually have two patterns, and these patterns are, in my view, are correlated with each other. So these patterns are called decomposition by domain and decomposition by subdomain. But overall, what I can say that for each particular business functionality, there should exist an independent microservice on a very high level. So how you decompose each business functionality now will depend how will you use this domain and subdomain. So the very common example that we give is of e-commerce site like Amazon or Walmart, where you could have a view for the different groceries or applications or items, you can say. So it could be like a view part, then you could have a payment part and order part, and then you could have the feedback part. So each of them is a complete independent business functionality. The payment part doesn't interfere with the view part, the feedback part doesn't interfere with the view part and the payment part. So it is like a subdomain to the whole e-commerce or domain, you can say. Moving to next question. Do you know difference between synchronous and asynchronous communication? Now, it may seem irrelevant to you for a microservice questions, but yes, it is very much important if you understand what is meant by synchronous, what is meant by asynchronous communication, again blocking IO, non-blocking IO, because your whole architecture design is based on this type of communications. I am saying this because microservice is a distributed architecture, and in this distributed architecture, each independent services will interact with each other over HTTP protocol. That is the reason you need to understand the difference between synchronous, asynchronous, synchronous plus blocking, asynchronous plus non-blocking IO. So to answer this, yes, I know the difference between synchronous and asynchronous communication. In case of synchronous communication, request is sent by the user and the user is waiting for the response or the error, whatever comes from the backend. or you can say the service. Debugging is easier because you know what the response will come at the same time itself, so you can also visualize errors if any and can track easily. User experience is poor if lots of concurrent user is there. It will consume lots of thread. Now this is related to how the client server model will operate if a lot of concurrent users will come into the picture. Now we will move to asynchronous communication. In case of asynchronous communication, request is sent and doesn't wait for receiving of the response, so the next process in line will continue to execute. So how do you store the response when it will be received? So for this, we have executors. So executors is used for asynchronous communications, and executor framework, if you remember, we have future and completable future with Java 8 for storing the result with the help of callback. Debugging is harder when error tracking is a bit difficult because working with asynchronous communication, sometimes it happens that for a particular asynchronous call, the same asynchronous call, you call another asynchronous and then again another asynchronous call. So it would be go like a chain of asynchronous communication going on to several extent. If we talk about good user experience, you may have used React framework or Angular framework. If you try to understand with an example of synchronous and asynchronous communication, let's understand like this. When you sign up for the first time, let's say if you're signing up Facebook or if you're signing up Gmail, you would have to enter username. So when you enter username, you would get message that username doesn't exist or username already exists. So how do it is checking that whether the username is already existing or doesn't exist when you are typing the keyword in the input field? This is done through asynchronous communication. If you talk about synchronous communication with the same example, after sign up, when you try to log in, you have to enter username and password. So when you put your username and password, the call is again made to the database to verify the username and password. So this call is going to be synchronous. Now let's move to the next question. Which is preferred in microservice, synchronous or asynchronous? There is no definite answer or rule to use of synchronous or asynchronous communication. It all depends upon your business use case. It may happen that in a particular project, you are using only synchronous communication. In another one, you are going to only use asynchronous communication. In the third one, you are making a combination of synchronous or asynchronous. So, for example, if I want to say a small company payroll system, so it is going to be a synchronous communication between the services and the users and the services and the database. Let's talk about a big company, a trading systems or card payment systems, then it's going to be a combination of asynchronous communication with non-blocking IO, that is generally we call reactive systems, as well as some part like authentication of the username password to be synchronous communication. Moving to next question. I do not want a shutdown time for my application. Can I deploy a new instance with zero downtime? If you're working in IT industry, you may have noticed that in your project, sometimes mails come for a production shutdown or time for shutdown for maintenance activity, such like this. But have you think how the Gmail works, how your WhatsApp, how your Facebook is working continuously? It never gives you notification about shutdown time or maintenance time. They are using a zero downtime version upgrade, or you can say system upgrade of their applications. So to do so, we have a term called a blue-green deployment. So let's understand what is meant by a blue-green deployment. Let's take an example of a middleware application where the input is a form of request. Maybe it could be XML, it could be REST, and where we are outputting something. So usually in the production, you would have three servers, let's say A, B, and C. And these servers would be behind the load balancers. So if a request is coming to the load balancer, depending upon the algorithm used, it will route to A, B, and C. Now let's suppose there is a jar, or you can say a var, in my server B. Jar and var, now I have changed and I want to deploy the new var. But at the same time, I don't want the user to give notification about the shutdown time. So if you have noticed that we have three servers, right? So what if in the server B, I will put the new jar and I will bounce the server B without bouncing the server A and server C. Bouncing means restarting the server. So when the server B is bouncing in the production, the load is balanced by server A and server C only. After bouncing of the server, and or you can say restart of the server B, again the load will be equally distributed between A, B, and C. Now the server B has the new version of the jar. If it is working fine, we can similarly do for the next servers A and C also, and then we can have the new version in all the three servers. If it is not working fine, again we remove the new version of byte.jar and put the older version of the byte.jar, and again rebounce the server. In case of microservice, or what usually we do in cloud native, because we do not have the physical servers, let's say you have the production environment, let's say where you have UI, backend API, and DB, and each packed as a container, or you can say if it is a platform as a service, you would have deployed as a jar. Also, you would not have a single environment of the production. You would have a pre-prod, or you can say a staging environment, right? So which is identical to the production environment. Now put all the new versions of your applications in the staging environment or pre-prod environment, which is identical to the production environment. So once ready, do UAT testing on this environment, and after you feel it is okay, we can go live. Just change the routing from production one environment to the stage environment or pre-prod environment. Changing the route means slowly diverting the traffic from production one to the staging environment. For a particular point of time, both will serve the request. So once the staging environment applications are working fine and you have get okay from the product owners, you can switch back the staging environment as the production environment and the production environment as staging environment. So this way you can keep switching your production and staging environment. It is one of the way to do a blue-green deployment. Either you can do to the servers behind the load balancers, or you can use the environment like production and pre-prod with the help of routing. Let's move to the next question. Do you know about a feed in DB context? So you can say, yes, I know what is meant by a feed term. ACID stands for atomicity, consistency, isolation and durability. It is mostly followed by the relational database. So example could be SQL, PostgreSQL. Atomicity means if transaction starts, either it should be completed completely or doesn't happen at all. So if the transaction fails, complete rollback should happen. Consistency means DB must be consistent before and after the transaction. In other words, you can say state of the DB should be a valid one after and before the transaction. Isolation means each transaction should happen in isolation. No two transactions should interfere with each other. Durability means if successful transaction happens, changes should be saved properly and reflected even if some system breakdown happens, some system failure happens. Moving to next question. I am using document NoSQL DB like Mongo. Can I achieve ACID? Now, if you look at this question, it may seem irrelevant to you because NoSQL DB does not work like SQL DB. So a document NoSQL DB like MongoDB up to some versions doesn't support the ACID context. Then I can say it all depends upon the version of MongoDB. But I should know that what is in the different versions of the MongoDB, or at least I should know the version of MongoDB I am using in my project and the latest version difference. With version 4.0 release, they are providing strong support for ACID properties. Not only MongoDB, other NoSQL DB like FaunaDB, Azure Cosmos DB also support ACID properties up to some extent or fully depending upon the version. How you handle versioning in microservices? To handle versioning in microservice, we have two approaches mainly. The first approach say URI versioning. By the term URI versioning means you would put the version in URI itself. For example, byte programming slash v2 slash videos. V2 indicates that the application is have now second version. Second approach is header versioning. So we can do so like example x-version 2.0. Now each of these approaches have the pros and cons, but mostly header versioning is preferred. Moving to the next question. How you have documented your microservice endpoints? Documentation is one of the important aspects of your application, or you can say your project, whether it is microservice or a monolithic one. In case of microservice, we can use Swagger for documentation. You can also use Spring REST docs. Now Swagger and Spring REST docs are completely a different way to utilize. If you are going for a minimum documentation where you can document only your API endpoints and what it can do, you can use Swagger because a single configuration file along with @enable Swagger annotation on the main Spring Boot application class would be needed. But if you're looking for more documentation, I would not say to prefer Swagger because then you are flushing your code with irrelevant Swagger annotations. So another best way to do if you want a complete documentation of your API what your endpoints is doing, what your models is doing, the information about the models, I would suggest to go for Spring REST docs. Spring REST docs is tightly coupled with your JUnit test case. So if you are changing anything in the JUnit, Spring REST docs will be automatically updated. One of the advantage of Spring REST docs is either way it is promoting test driven development. So this was all about interview questions. Subscribe and stay tuned for more upcoming videos about Spring Boot, Java, Cloud and Cloud Native Architecture Design.